Cut and carved by the Colorado River, Arizona's Grand Canyon covers more ground than the country of Luxembourg. It's 277 miles long, as much as 18 miles wide in some places, and more than a mile deep.
It's not the largest on Earth, or the widest, or the deepest, but it's the grandest.
Almost 6 million people visit the Grand Canyon every year. Here, they can witness unsurpassed vistas.
When you walk to the edge of the Grand Canyon, most people just gasp, looking down into it and asking themselves, what am I seeing? It's hard to get your mind around the scale of it.
Along with magnificent views, those who visit the canyon's upper rim and the floor far below may also experience extreme contrasts in its weather. That's because the canyon itself actually changes the weather within it. The different widths and depths create separate zones of heat and cold called microclimates.
A microclimate is essentially a climate based on either topography or location that's different than the overall general climate of the area.
A summer day can be 80 degrees at the top of the canyon and more than 20 degrees hotter at the bottom.
At the bottom near the river, you get more and denser air during the summertime, and when you get a little daytime heat mixed into that, your temperatures can swell over 100 degrees.
The Grand Canyon's vast vistas are remarkable, but weather can change the views in startling ways. A process called orographic lift helps form clouds above the canyon. When wind encounters a barrier, like a rock wall thousands of feet high, it is forced to rise. As the air shoots up through increasingly colder temperature zones, it can cool to the dew point, and clouds form over the canyon. But sometimes, thanks to one of the Grand Canyon's rare phenomena, clouds form within the canyon itself.
So imagine this. You pull up to the Grand Canyon for the first time, you look over the edge, and all you see is clouds.
How do you get clear skies above a canyon filled with an ocean of clouds? The secret is unlocked by a process called inversion.
What happens is overnight, your temperatures drop and you have cold air at the base of this ravine. When the sun comes out, you begin to warm things up.
The air above that cold air pool will get a little warmer. Well, that warm air actually traps the colder air down there. And because of that and the moisture that's there with the river, that will cause a cloud or fog.
It is beautiful to look at, but treacherous to be underneath.
The Grand Canyon, a majestic sight and a geological paradox. The Colorado River began carving it out less than 6 million years ago, but the rocks that the river reveals are billions of years older.
So the difference between the million-year time frame of canyon carving and the billion-year time frame of the rocks is hard to get your mind around.
The oldest rocks in Grand Canyon are at the very bottom of the canyon. And that is the Vishnu Schist.
The Vishnu Schist is a black layer of hard metamorphic rock, all that remains of one of Earth's lost wonders. What is now a canyon was once a mighty mountain range. 1.8 billion years ago, two tectonic plates collide, pushing up pinnacles of rock some 6 miles into the sky. The Vishnu Mountains tower over the Earth in what is now Arizona, only to be worn away by time and the elements.
All of these erosion agents, wind and water and glaciers and ice, act together to tear down mountains.
Over hundreds of millions of years, peaks that rival Everest are stripped down to their rocky roots. There's still no canyon, just a flat, dry plain. But that's not the end of the story, as revealed by strange fossils in unexpected places. These fossils are trilobites, extinct animals that first evolved around 500 million years ago and only lived underwater.
Trilobites were bottom dwellers, so they would walk around the seafloor and would try to prey on other arthropods or worms or things like that.
When we look at fossils, we can tell easily they were deposited in a marine setting.
That means half a billion years ago, the Grand Canyon area was once covered by prehistoric seas. Over the next 420 million years, the seas alternately flood and recede from the plain. The seas don't just cover the ground, they add to it, bringing in deposits of sediment that, over millions of years, build up into layers that can be clearly seen today.
So if you're a geologist, you come to the Grand Canyon, and then you work your way down through all the different layers of spectacular colors. Each one has a different chapter. It's telling us about the evolution of life on Earth.
Strangely, scientists discover some trilobite fossils far higher than the ancient seas ever reached. How can that be? What carried the trilobite fossils so high? To unlock that mystery, we look back in time and beneath the Earth.
To understand the Grand Canyon, you also have to understand the uplift of the Colorado Plateau and of the Rocky Mountains.
Between 50 million and 70 million years ago, tectonic plates collide again. The land is uplifted, water recedes, and fossils are carried high above sea level.
One of the interesting things about the uplift of the western U.S. is it resulted in mountains, the Rocky Mountains, and it also resulted in the Colorado Plateau, big flat areas, really, where the sedimentary rocks are uplifted without being tilted.
Then, about 5.5 million years ago, the Colorado River flows from the Rockies and rushes over the edge of the steep plateau. Gravity speeds the river, which is filled with rocky debris. A gash forms in the plateau. As the river gathers force with a succession of drop-offs, the gash deepens, moving back along the plateau, finally forming the basis of the Grand Canyon we know today.
It's that elevation which gives the river its carving power that enables it to carve through solid rock. So in a way, you could say that without the uplift of the Colorado Plateau, there could not be a Grand Canyon.
But if water carved the canyon, why is the Grand Canyon 18 miles across and the average width of the Colorado River is only 300 feet? We unlock that secret by looking into another way weather affects the Grand Canyon, the freeze-thaw cycle. As rain seeps into the surrounding rock, some water gets trapped, and when temperatures cool, it expands, pressing against the surrounding rock. Temperatures rise and fall over thousands and millions of years. The water and ice expand and contract, and rock gives way as a single crack grows into a whole new channel. And 5.5 million years later, the Grand Canyon is still a work in progress and a geologic laboratory for scientists.
The walls of the Grand Canyon are carving down the thickness of a piece of paper every year. The things we learn from researching the rocks and the landscapes of Grand Canyon have global reverberations in terms of our understanding the Earth.